On Wednesday night, we're talking about the doctrine of predestination. Predestination is the most misunderstood doctrine in the world. That's because people don't know what it means. It has a meaning. When you start defining words, people get all bent out of shape because they don't want to know what something means. They say, well, what's wrong with the King James Bible? The King James Bible is what I use, but that is not the inspired Word of God. Let me show you one more time. There's some here that haven't been here before. Here is the inspired Word of God, and it's called the Textus Receptus. There was no English 2,000 years ago. Middle English started somewhere around 900 A.D. I mean, early English, about 900 A.D. Middle English around 1100 A.D. And the late English, developing into what we have today, and it took hundreds of years to do that, started somewhere around 1300. And the inspired Word of God is in the Greek. It's this Greek text right here. It's called the Textus Receptus. And then, of course, directly under it is the English word. But don't trust the English words, because these are men who were just translators. They were human beings like us. And even in the King James Bible, which comes out of the Textus Receptus, it has to come from somewhere. When it comes from the Textus Receptus, what you had with King James, his mother was Mary Queen of Scots, and she had an heirship. She was heir to three thrones, to Scotland, England, and France. And she was shifting back and forth, and she had been raised by Jesuit priests who were very devious, and they taught her how to be adapt to whatever she needed to adapt to, and she couldn't make up her mind whether she wanted to be a Protestant or a Roman Catholic. Well, she passed this on to her son, who was King James, and King James the First was the one who commissioned a translation of the Bible be written, and and King James had 53 translators. Six of them dropped out. They ended up with, or seven of them dropped out, and they ended up with 46 translators. And these 46 translators were half Roman Catholic and half Protestant, in fact, half Calvinist. These were predestinationists fighting with free will Catholics over what to put in the text. And you say, what's such a big deal about that? Well, that's because whenever you do a translation in the Greek, you've got, for every word in the Greek, well, not every word, you've got 16 ways to translate some words. You got 27 to translate others, and then some words you have the singular, you have the plural. Then in the singular you've got masculine, feminine, neuter gender. In the plural you got masculine, feminine, neuter gender. And then you've got nominative case, genitive case, dative case, accusative case. You say, I don't know what nominative case is. Well, certainly you do. It's the subject of the sentence. Well, anytime you're looking up something in Strong's Concordance, when you're looking up a word, Mr. Strong cannot give you every one of these cases, and he cannot give you masculine, feminine, neuter in the plural and masculine, feminine, neuter in the singular. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 24. 2, 2, 3, 2, 4. Excuse me, I'm leaving one out. Okay, and I went blank for a minute. So you got 24 ways to spell most words in the Bible. And I guess my favorite, one of my favorite words is to show how they have really twisted and polluted the Word of God. Well, two of my favorite words, they've been translated the word good, and then you've got the word love. The word love, well, when you look up the word good, you've got two words that's been ambiguously translated from the Greek language into the word good. You have the word, what are the two words? Agathos, A-G-A, T-H-O-S. And what's the other word?
I don't know.
No.
You are,
good. Unto him that knoweth to do good, James 4:17. Kalos. Thank you, Mike. Kalos. Agathos is what God does in our life, and kalos is what we do towards God. This is the word found in Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good, for agathos, or for beneficial. And then kalos, that's what we do when the Bible says we're not to go around talking about ourselves, saying, I'm going to do such and such, and I'm going to build me a business, and I'm going to build this house, and I'm going to paint it this and make this many square feet. The Bible says when you talk about yourself like that, that you are proud and you're rejoicing in your boastings, and that word boast is A-L-A-Z-O-N-I-A, and that is the word self-esteem or self-confidence. And that's the same word, 1 John 2:16, all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Pride is self-esteem. It's not of the Father, it's of the world. Well, kalos means beautiful or what fits. And that's what we do. Unto him that knoweth to do good and quit talking about himself, unto him that knoweth to do good and stop sounding his own trumpet. Well, you've got agathos. If you look up the word agathos, he'll only give you nominative case, masculine gender singular. In all the rest of these, you'll have A-G-A-T-H. Then you'll have a different ending. The stem stays the same. The stem stays the same. And then you've got 24 ways to spell this word agathos. And then you've got 24 ways to spell kalos. And yet they took both of these words and translated them into G-O-O-D in the English. Now, how are you going to translate that? You can't translate that. And, of course, love. Love has to do with predestination. Love has to do with predestination. When you get into love, you've got two common words, actually three words. One is not in the New Testament. You have the word agape, and then you have the word phileo, and what? Eros. Eros, we get the word erotic. That means just the lustful sexual desire.
Freaky.
Huh?
Freaky.
What?
Freaky.
Freaky.
Yeah.
Oh. Well, it's a lust, it's a desire, it's a lust, it's a sexual desire. And phileo means to have affection. Now, affection is not something you have to teach somebody. It's there by nature. I have an affection for yellow cake with chocolate icing. That is my favorite all-time cake of all time. I have an affection for banana pudding. That is my favorite all-time pudding. And no one ever taught me that. That's something that's in my tongue and in my mind. And I don't know how. But see, phileo is not something you teach anybody. It's something that you're drawn to by your very nature because it's appealing. Agape is something you have to learn because agape has to do with the commandment, doesn't it? Has to do with the commandment. And of course, agape, probably the best definition is in 2 John. Always, your best definition, it comes from the textual definition. I had a Greek professor tell me one time, he said, you're going to find just as much in the text as you are in the Greek definition. Well, 2 John 6 says, herein is agape, herein is love, that we walk after his commandments. Now, a lot of people have said to me, you keep saying that this is a relationship that a father has for a son. And here is Kittle's Theological Dictionary of the New Testament. And this has got to show you agape. Here's everything on agape. So if you're going to, hold on here. This is a 10-volume set of words, of New Testament Greek words, and I've got the full set upstairs, but I brought this down here. Now, you've got from page, this is in volume 1, from page 21 to page 54. All that is on agape. You get a real simple definition from Strong's, and it's not really a correct definition. Herein is agape, that we walk after His commandments. Now, let me read something to you, so this will help some people. Now, talking about agape, the clear development of the concept of love into a dogma in Deuteronomy has some most important consequences. This fact is bound up specifically with the close interrelating to the dogma of election. It is tied, agape is tied to election. Because what are we elected to in 1 Peter 1 and 2?
Obedience.
We're elected to obedience. Elect unto obedience. And what else? And the sprinkling of blood. And a blood baptism was a death. When you die to self, you quit obedience to self. And we're elected unto obedience. And if agape is walking in a commandment and God never changes or mutates, then our obedience is to agape, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Right? So that's why he's saying here, election has to do with the dogma of election. Then he goes on to say, so that it is involved in the process of hardening which the latter doctrine undergoes. We can see this by way of example in the use made of the thought in Malachi. At the beginning, we have a statement that startles us by its very simplicity. I love you, saith Yahweh, talking about, I've loved Jacob and hated Esau before either one were born, before either one had done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand. That's in the 9th chapter of Romans. God loved Jacob, hated Esau, and people say, well, that's an unrighteous God. No, He can kill whoever He wants to and send to hell who He wants to. He said, I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. I'll have mercy on whom I will have mercy. And whom He will, He hardeneth. He hardened the heart of Pharaoh. Pharaoh did not harden his own heart. This message, however, is not understood with the depth and consequent breadth found in the Word, but it provides the occasion for a remarkable discussion of the question how this love works itself out and what is its basis. This can hardly be meant as a question of truth, but only as a question of law. Law is something you obey, isn't it? So when you're obedient to agape, you're obedient to a law, to the law of God. And let me skip on down here. Let me see. Let me read on down. Inquiry is made into the circumstances which have the fact as consequence or presupposition. Thus the tenderness of the thought is violated and its force shattered. As the continuation shows, the good news is unfortunately estimated according to its legal implications. The good news of agape has to do with legal implications. It's a law that God gives us. These are shown to consist in the privileged status of Jacob as compared with Esau. That's because God loved Jacob and hated Esau. And what is love? Walking in a commandment. What was Jacob's name changed to? Israel. And who did God give His laws to? Israel. The misfortune of the Esau-Edom discloses that he is hated by Yahweh, hated by Jehovah. Esau was hated by Jehovah before he was born. Whereas Jacob should learn to regard the fact that he is spared the same fate as proof of the love or the agape of Yahweh or Jehovah. If the use of the usual marital terms may have had some influence in producing this antithesis, there is still every reason to deplore the distortion of the thought of love in the argumentation. Yahweh loves because He hates. Even the thought of the Father is mutilated in this book. Now, I've said so many times, it's the relationship that a father has for his son. And people say, where do you get that? Well, I taught on that a few weeks ago from a biblical perspective, but let me read the rest of this to you. It is expounded as a legal claim against the priest. If then I be a father, says Yahweh to them, where is mine honor? Where are you being obedient to me? What he's saying, if you have love towards me, you'll do what I say. If your kids say they love you and they won't be obedient to you and do what you say, they don't love you, do they? That also has to do with obedience. Or, let me read this now, or it is almost completely reduced, agape is almost completely reduced to a relationship of service such as obtains between a father and the son who works in his business. Where did I get that? Out of here. But I went through and showed how the Bible says there in Hebrews 12, whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son. Whom he agapes, he chastens and scourges his son, so they'll walk according to his agape, correct? So, and he said, the ones who are not scourged, they are bastards and no son of mine. Therefore, I don't love them. God does not love everybody in the world. He does not. The Bible doesn't say that. Amen. What about John 3:16? God so loved. So loved. Loved is a verb. So. What is so? It's an adverb. Adverbs tells how, when, or where. It tells how or in what fashion God loved. It doesn't say he loved everybody in the world. So limits. It puts a limitation on the love. Not that God's love wasn't sufficient for all mankind, but he limited it because he said, for God so loved, or in this fashion, he loved the world, and love there is agape. And every time the Bible speaks of love of God towards man, it's always agape. God, when the Bible says God is love, love your neighbor, love your enemy, it's always agape. It's never phileo. So when God so loves, so is the word H-E-A-U-T-A-U, huta, it means in this fashion he loved. But he didn't love everybody. He limited it by the word so. So is a limitation. He so loved. He didn't love everybody. He so loved the world. And besides that, the word world isn't people. It isn't globe. It isn't dust. The word world is cosmos. Well, how you get that, Jim Brown? Well, you can get it out of an interlinear Bible. You can go to the very word, and it's in here. Or you can go into Strong's Concordance, and he'll tell you that. In cosmos, it doesn't mean he loved everybody in the world. He so loved the cosmos, and that is the word orderly arrangement, and it is masculine and gender. Well, how do you look up masculine? How do you know that? Gosh, I don't know. I'm guessing. Okay. I made it up. No, you take a parsing guide, and little at a time, I know everybody here doesn't know how to use a parsing guide, but I'll show you a little at a time. One night, we'll on our textual criticism night, we'll just stop and go through how to use a parsing guide and how to use your first year Greek book so you can know how to look up the parts of speech in the Greek. The Bible has been mistranslated into the English. My favorite way to show everybody that is this. This is the definite article, the. T-H-E. They got 24 ways to spell it in the Greek. What are you going to do with that? 24 ways. And when Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, he used the word, hey, that's feminine gender. Jesus isn't a female. I wonder what that means. Gosh, let's forget it. It don't matter, does it? Oh, yes, it does. Because he was talking to the church. The church is the wife or the bride of Christ. And he just got through telling the apostles, and the way you know, it's already written in your heart. You're the church. You're my wife. I am the way that's written in your heart, your female wife, church, bride, heart. Does it matter? Well, sure it does. Now, I don't know how I got off on this, but I keep wanting to come back to agape because nobody knows what it means. Well, when you get a predestination, everybody says, well, God loves everybody. No, he doesn't. He hates all workers of iniquity there in the fifth chapter. If God really wanted to get everybody, he loves all these people in hell, and he's just crying and weeping for eternity because he couldn't get them to do what he wanted them to do because they had a power that was stronger than him. He was the living God, and they had something called free will. It is so stupid. He's God. He does what he pleases. Our God sits in the heavens, and he's done whatsoever he hath pleased. Nobody's getting away with nothing with God. Look at Psalms 135. I got to give you this. This kind of connects with last week. Psalms 135. This goes with Ecclesiastes 3:14. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. And God doeth it that men should fear before him. God has done everything from forever to forever. Forever, the word olam means it always has been, it always will be. So he's done things from always, from eternity. Verse 6, whatsoever the Lord pleased, if Satan didn't get in the way, that did he in heaven. Huh?
No.
Oh, was that not there? Oh, excuse me. Whatsoever the Lord pleased, that did he in heaven and in earth and the seas and all the deep places. He causeth the vapors to ascend from the ends of the earth. He maketh lightnings for the rain. Goes back to 37th chapter of Job, doesn't it? God said, the lightnings are mine. I love that verse. I'm sorry, I got to read it one more time. I love that. Look at Job 37. Job 37. Job 37. I'm just going to stick this in there, but I'm not going to go to all of them. Job 37. At this, verse 1, at this my heart trembled and is moved out of his place. Hear attentively the noise of his voice and sound that goeth out of his mouth. He directeth it unto the whole heaven and his lightnings to the end of the earth. He directs his lightnings. And look over here in chapter 38. God is speaking to Job and he says, Job, verse 35, canst thou send lightnings that they may go and say unto thee, here we are, lightning bolts reporting for duty. Where shall we strike and who do you want us to kill, living God? What great dam would you like to strike and not completely out? What plane do you want us to knock out of the air? And that stupid Jesse Duplantis said, well, if I'm in a plane and a lightning strikes and coats the plane, I say, ha-ha, devil, you missed me. I'm sorry, the lightning bolts don't belong to the devil. They belong to God. That's called an act of God.
Chapter 38:31.
Huh? 38:1. Canst thou bind the sweet influences of Pleiades and loose the bands of Orion?
My flowers have been coming up.
Yeah. You know, the rabbis said that the Pleiades was the seven stars in the left shoulder of Taurus. That's what they said. And they said the Pleiades, they called that the morning star. Well, who is the morning star? That's Jesus. And they said that they called that the seven stars. Well, notice in Amos, the fifth chapter, Amos says, seek him who maketh the seven stars in Orion. The Pleiades was the seven stars on the left shoulder of Taurus. Orion was the evening star in the winter. And the rabbins, which is plural for rabbi, the rabbins said that the Pleiades drew the sap up into the vine and gave them crops, and there was no famine. He said, Job, I can bind the sweet influences of Pleiades. The sweet influences of Pleiades doesn't mean the stars are influencing your life. Need to go call a palm reader. No. The sweet influences of Pleiades is the smell of the apple blossoms, the new mown hay. And he said, I can loose the bands of Orion. Loosing the bands of Orion is getting into the middle of winter and then bringing a warm front in and then hitting you with a cold snap and killing all the crops in the middle of the winter. Mm-hmm. That's what the rabbis said they did. As to whether they did it is neither here nor there. God uses their terminology and says, can you bind the sweet influences of Pleiades? I can stop the crops from coming in the spring. I think that's who. And who did they go seeking after instead of Jehovah God, who was their fertility God? Who did they seek after? Went after Saturn, went after Hercules. His birthday was December the 25th. They went after Mithra. His birthday was December the 25th. They went after this sun god that Constantine brought in the church and called the Christ Mass. Aren't we crazy? I'm not going to go any further than that. I got to get back to Romans 8:29. I got too many things to say. I like that. Go back to Psalms 135. He causeth the vapors to ascend from the ends of the earth. He maketh lightnings for the rain. Our God sits in the heavens and he's doing as he pleases. And what the Lord pleased, that did he in the heavens and the earth and the seas and the deep places. Verse 7, he bringeth the wind out of his treasuries. When cyclones and when hurricanes hit something, that's God killing people. He holds the keys of death. He said, I kill, I make alive. I wound, I heal. There in Deuteronomy 32-39. He smote the firstborn of Egypt, both man and beast. He killed those firstborn. People say, God don't kill. He killed them. Who sent tokens and wonders into the midst of thee, O Egypt, upon Pharaoh and upon all his servants. He smote great nations and slew mighty kings. God killed them. Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan, and all the kingdoms of Canaan, he killed them. People say, God don't kill, he killed them. And he gave their land for inheritance, and heritage unto Israel, his people. Thy name, O Lord, endureth forever, and my memorial, O Lord, throughout all generations. God does everything he's pleased to do. The snow is his. He said, I say to the frost, be on the ground, it's there. Snowstorms belong to God. When men die in snowstorms, that's God. When men die in World Trade Centers and airlines crash into them, that's God. It's outrageous. People say, men, God's not doing this. He said, I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all things in Isaiah 45:7. He said, I put evil in the hearts of men to do these things. I've got some vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. And I heard somebody the other day say, well, there were believers in the World Trade Centers. Well, if there were, they meant to be the Lord, didn't they? Yeah. They were better off than this. And if there were a bunch of vessels of wrath, they went to hell. That's the way the Bible says it. Now, we're predestined to conform to the image of Christ. Predestination is not just about God killing somebody and sending somebody to heaven. Predestination is more than just that. Predestination is about accountability and being like Christ and being like Jesus. Romans 8:29. Our verse, here it is, Romans 8:29. This is our theme verse through this. And we're talking about being like Jesus. Like predestination. Predestination is about, and people don't even know what it's about. It's about being like Jesus. That's what it is. Well, when you come to a place where you come to understanding that you're a sinner, that you're, and that Christ is birthing you into his kingdom, and you begin repentance, you're immature. You're not like Jesus when you're a young baby Christian. You may be all wound up. You get all wound up, you get wound down real quick. You get wound up and say, boy, I'm ready to be on fire for God. I was telling Mike the other night that living for Christ is not always fun. Sometimes it's very hard. It's very difficult. I said, you can leave me and him and Billy were working out at the gym the other day. I said, you can leave and walk out that door. You can say, this is too hard. Christmas being paganism and predestination being true and daily cross and death to self and self-denial is just too hard, and these other preachers aren't preaching this. I said, you can walk out that door there, and you go out, and the weather is still dreary January weather, and you can go to your apartment alone and go to your job alone and buy your groceries alone, and it's still the same world and it's still the same dreary drudgery, except you got nobody believing truth with you. You can leave it, and that's where you end up, because it's still the same old world, isn't it? You can go back to where you were, Phyllis. You can, and if you do, you're going to be there alone, aren't you? You'll be there alone. But thank God that God has got a family. And I was saying this to somebody last night. I think it's Mike. I talked to him a lot. I preached to him a lot. He has to catch it from me. I said, Mike, he said, I met a girl up there at Ball State. I said, tell her the truth. I said, tell her predestination's true and Christmas is paganism. Hit her real quick, just boom, like that. And Eric's laughing, and I told him about Eric. I said, Eric's our son, for those y'all don't know. And he met Karen. He said, Christmas is pagan and predestination's true. He said, I want to see if I could run her off. And she said, I believe that.
Well, actually, I told her about predestination first, and that didn't get her away. And I said, if this will, Christmas is pagan. Why?
She didn't leave. Sorry. And here's the point. People, you have to realize this. You have to realize this. I told Mike, I said, and all the young, we got a lot of single guys here. Go out there and just tell every girl you run across, Christmas is pagan, and predestination's true. And hey, you, Chris, come here. Christmas is pagan, predestination's true, and you're predestined to conform. You have to deny yourself. And one of these days, if you'll tell enough of them, one of them's going to say, guys, I didn't think anybody ever say that to me. I've been waiting. Besides that, she may not like you, Mike. She may like David, and David might like her. Bring her, and maybe they'll get you one. I mean, I keep saying it. Do y'all realize we laugh at this, but this is true. They either have all of the elect have the Word of God written in their hearts. And when we say predestination is true, Romans 8:29 says it is, and it has an exact definition, say it so hard it will make a goat infuriated enough to punch you in the mouth. But it will not make the elect that way. The elect will say, I've been looking for somebody to believe this for a long time.
That's right.
The elect will recognize the truth. So just go around experimenting. Just pretend you're a scientist. Go around. I'm looking for people who believe this. Hey, do you believe that predestination is true in Christmas paganism? No. And then go keep going, and you're going to hit one. It's already written in their hearts. You can't say it too hard to the elect. You can't feed dog food to dogs and make them mad. I can bring Cricket down here, and I'll promise you, we'll fill up, we'll say, look here, Cricket, you take this dog food or else. And she goes, no. She won't pay any attention to your tone of voice. She will eat. She will eat it as long as you put it in front of her. And you cannot make sheep permanently angry with sheep food. It can't be done. And all of the elect have the light written in their hearts, and we're just turning it on. We're just flipping the switch. That's all. I guess y'all think I'm real hard. I really believe what Paul said when he said, seeing we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. Great plainness, polis, parhesia, P-O-L-U-S, great, P-A-R-R-H-E-S-I-A. Polis means often, or as often as you do it. If it's all day long, use parhesia, be blunt. Be to the point. Don't circumvent. Don't beat around the bush. Get straight to it. And the sheep will hear great plainness of speech. That's what they hear. Sheep go to some mushy church and go, the preacher's talking in circles. I don't know what he's talking about. He's saying stuff and it don't make any sense. And it just, and I get dizzy when he does that. That's what mush does to sheep. But what great plainness does, it wakes them up. People think, they accuse me of being angry. I am angry at false teachers. I'm not angry at sheep. I love the sheep enough to tell them the truth. Get over and eat this food. I'll pitch it at them as far as I can see, and they will get a hold of it. Everybody has a really hard time just being blunt with family and friends, don't you? Just do it, because it's written there. It's written there, or it's not. You're not convincing anyone to come to Christ. The Holy Spirit does that, and He's the one that's written the Word on fleshy tables of the heart, not you. He's the one that does the convincing. Say it as hard, as plain as you can. Sometimes when I run across somebody out in public, and they're giving me a hard time. I run across a guy at the gym, and I had one of my T-shirts. I always make statements with my T-shirts. I've got proskuneo, which is the word worship, with a bunch of wolves on one. And I got Jesus carrying a cross on another. And he said, I like your shirt. So I started talking to him and hitting him with some Greek words. And he kind of, oh, my God. So I walked up to the next day, and I did this. I said, I believe in predestination, and Christmas is paganism. Did you know that? Since he was already grumpy, I just walked up to him. I said, did you know that I believe in predestination, and Christmas is pagan? He went, yeah, I know that. I just want to make sure he knew what I believed in. And if he's elect, just that much information will cut their heart out if they're elect. Did you know that? I won't wrestle with them long. When some guy gets contrary with me, I go straight to him and say, here's what I believe. And I don't even try to convince him, huh?
You do a fit for you.
Yeah, I do. Just like Joab. Like Joab, don't I? He's always planting his knife under somebody's fifth rib. Now, predestination, what it's about? It's about agape. It's about going to heaven. But mainly it's about living like Christ. So let's look at it one more time. Romans 8:29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. But he didn't just predestinate us. We are all nonconformist. We won't conform to Christ. There's nothing good in us to conform to Christ. Paul said there's none good, not one. There's none understand, and nobody seeks after God. None. Well, that means nobody. It means none. Paul said, how to perform that which is good I find not in me. I don't know how to do right. That's what he said. Present tense. He's talking about what he's writing to the church at Rome. Well, if he don't know how to do right, how are we going to do right? Goodness. That's a good question. I think God's going to have to change us, change our hearts. First of all, we start off, we're born. We're born, we come to the knowledge of good and evil, just like Adam. Of good and evil. And Adam was innocent just like we were. And he came to the tree, the knowledge of good and evil. And when we come to that tree, John said, that's all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Those are the same three things Eve saw in the tree. Good for food, lust of the flesh. It was the pleasant to the eyes. The lust of the eyes, it would make her wise. She could be proud of herself and her own conceits. So that's all that's in the world. When we come to all that's in the world, we come to the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We go straight to the tree. We go straight to sin. That's our nature. We go straight to sin and we die. We're dead in our sin. Here we are, a big pile of dung. That's what we are. Just a big pile of dung. Now, if we ever come alive, how are we going to come alive since we're just a big pile of dung or dirt? How are we going to, if we ever quickened, the word is Z-O-O-P-O-I-E-O, zoompo-e-o, comes from pa-e-o, mean to make. You go to a zoo to see living animals, That is the Greek word alive. It means make alive. Now, let me ask you this. How is a pile of dung going to make itself alive? Huh? Does it have enough? Does it have enough flies or something in there, some enough muck to will to come alive? Now I'll tell you what. Now I'll tell you what free will is. Free will is. Beelzebub. That's free will. Because Beelzebub means Lord of the Flies, and they worship Beelzebub in the Hindu countries, and they say that since life comes out of dung, since flies, they say that flies come out of dung. They don't know that flies are planting their larvae there. And they say life comes out of dung. That's free will. So they worship the Lord of the Flies. They say dung can bring itself alive. Free will is Hinduism. Can dung make itself alive? No. If a man ever comes alive, Ephesians 2:1, and you hath he quickened, and you hath he made alive which were born. He said, which in times past you walked according to this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. He said, you hath he quickened, made alive. God made us alive. We did not make ourselves alive. Over there in John, if you look at John 6, verse 63, Jesus says, it is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. Your flesh can profit nothing. And one of those lame brain charismatics came up and said, oh, that's our spirit quickening. Our spirit's dead. The Holy Spirit is the truth. Thy word is truth. It's the word that quickens us and makes us alive, doesn't it? Of his own will beget he us by the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits there in James 1:18. He made us alive. We didn't make ourselves alive. John 1:13, the Bible says that we were born, speaking of the new birth, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. We were not born by our will. Now let me say one thing about this. Were you willing? After you were alive, you were willing. Just because you can remember being willing, it doesn't mean that you made yourself alive. God chose his elect. Let me give you something about 1 Corinthians 2:14. Read 65, okay. And therefore said I unto you that there that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. You can't. God has to give it to a man to come. And verse 44 says no man can come to me. Look at bracket verse 44. No man can come to me except my Father which has sent me draw him. The word draw, helko, means to drag in. It does not mean to have a magnetic pull. Unless God drags you in, you're not coming. Unless he makes us alive, man can't make himself alive. He cannot accept Christ. Let me show you something about accept Christ I haven't shown you. You can't accept Christ. The Bible says so. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 2:14. I want to show you something about this verse. Because a lot of people think we're saying something we're not saying. 1 Corinthians 2:14. I'm trying to get back to being accountable. 1 Corinthians 2:14. Let's read 13:14. Speaking of God or the Spirit. Let's read 12. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God. That's the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's truth, John 14, 16, 17, John 15, 26, John 16, 13, 1 John 5 and 6, the Spirit is the truth. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, the Holy Spirit, which is thy word, which is truth, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. He's given us things, but he had to give us the Spirit. He had to give us the truth to make us alive in order for us to receive them. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth. And what's the Holy Ghost? The truth. And he lives in us, doesn't he? And he teaches us truth. Which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. We do that all the time in the Bible, don't we? But the natural man, in opposition of this spiritual man in verse 12 and 13, the natural man or the dead man. Now the natural man, that's the word psychikos, P-S-U-C-H-I-K-O-S. C-H-I-K-O-S. That's the word natural. It means sensual, or it's the physical man. The physical man is the one of the senses. Now let me show you who the physical man is. Hold your place right here. Go to James 3. James 3. James 3. Look here. The word, verse 15, speaking of man's wisdom. Look at 14. But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom, the wisdom that's bitter envying and glories not and lies against the truth, this wisdom descendeth not from above. Now, the word above, I'm sure, is the word anno. You have that? Is it anno or anothen, one of the two? Is it anno?
The word truth?
No, the word above. Anothen. 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 Look here. The wisdom, this evil wisdom, receiveth not from above. The word anothen is the word in John, the third chapter, when Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. It's the word anothen. He's saying, the wisdom of this world does not come from the new birth. In fact, anothen, which is the word again, comes from anno, meaning the top or the brim, or from heaven, and it comes from the root anti, meaning in opposition to, or instead of. You have to have a birth from above that opposes the flesh, and this wisdom that's filled with strife and glories not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from the new birth. It doesn't descend from the righteous man, but is earthly, sensual. That's the word psychikos, the same word as natural. It comes from the dead man. Devilish. The word devilish is D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. It is our word demon. Daemonion, there's no such thing as demons. Now, that sure is a plain statement for me to make. Nobody's ever heard me preach on this before. Believe me, there's no such thing. I've got about 200 tapes on demons. If you want them, we'll send them to you. Daemon comes from the root dio, meaning to distribute fortunes. Satan's whole purpose is to fulfill the flesh. He took Jesus on a high mountain in Matthew 4 and said, fall down and worship me. I'll give you the fortunes of the world. Now, notice, the sensual man is devilish. His wisdom doesn't come from the new birth, does it? It doesn't come from above, from being born again. So go back here to 1 Corinthians 2:14. The psychikos man is sensual, he's devilish, he fulfills the flesh, he receiveth not the things of truth. The Holy Spirit is truth. Thy word is truth, John 17:17. He receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. The dead man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Neither can he know him, because they're spiritually discerned. This verse says, you cannot accept Christ and the things of Christ till after you are born from above, till after you're born again. You can't accept Christ because the word receiveth is the word D-E-C-H-O-M-A-I. Dekomai is the word receiveth. Dek, 10, that's the word 10. A decade is 10 years. Decalogue, that is the 10 commandments. 10 words of God comes from deca and logos. That's the word, 10 words. Well, the word dekomai, it says the dead man, the man that's sensual, the sensual man, the psychikos man, the physical man, the man who wants to distribute fortunes to himself. He's got a wisdom of this world that only dead man can receive. And he can't receive spiritual. He cannot. The word dekomai means to reach out the 10 fingers and accept an offer that's been given. The dead man can't do that. But the living man will do that. Do you see what I'm saying? I've never said this before. When people say, I remember accepting Christ, I don't doubt your sincerity. Whatever you've accepted from Christ had to come about after you were alive. Dead men can't accept Christ or any spiritual thing. The Bible says so. Now, I know a lot of people walk the aisle. Walking the aisle don't help you. Aisles are, that's Roman Catholicism. That comes out of the Anglican Church. The Methodists kept that in their church when they came out of the Church of England. The Church of England kept that when they seceded from Roman Catholicism. They kept the altar. And the Methodists brought that into their camp meetings in the early 1800s, and it bled over to the Baptist churches, and they got the altar. That altar was where the Catholics walked down the aisle, knelt down, stuck their tongue out, and accepted Eucharist, or they accepted Christ through that transubstantiation where they said it became the literal body of Christ. Walk the aisle, and an altar, walking the aisle in the church, is Roman Catholicism. That's what it is. Now, you cannot accept Christ, but when you're alive, you can accept the things of the Spirit of God, and you will accept them because God gives us imperative moods. That's a command. He'll say, humble yourself under the hand of God, and he's not inviting us to. That's imperative mood. It's a command. Well, if that's God doing it, when he uses an imperative command, let there be light. The light doesn't say, well, now, if you'll give me an invitation to him and sing 25 verses just as I am, maybe I will be. Imperative moods are commands by the living God. It has to happen. Yeah, I'm an organist here. Now, you can accept spiritual things, and not only can you, but you will, because God commands his children to receive these things after they're birthed. If you remember when you first had conviction, it wasn't the walking the aisle. It wasn't the saying the sinner's prayer. Just utterly amazes me. The Bible says you can't accept Christ when you're dead, and the Bible says you can't pray the sinner's prayer when you're dead. We know that God heareth not sinners. John 9:31, if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. You don't call on a God you don't believe in. Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But the next verse says, how then shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? Has anybody here ever prayed to Zeus before? Has anybody ever prayed to Hercules? Has anybody ever prayed to Buddha? But why? I don't understand. Why hasn't anybody ever prayed to Buddha? Huh? Don't believe in him. Oh, that's it. Oh, that's right. Y'all don't believe in him, and I don't either. We don't pray to gods we don't believe in, and neither does unbelieving people pray to a living God. You don't pray to a God you don't believe in, do you? No. So the accept Christ sinner's prayer is not true. But were you willing to call upon a God after you immediately, there's something tugged at your heart and turned you around? A lot of people walk the aisle, they're willing to pray a prayer because they're already believers, but walking the aisle and praying a prayer has nothing to do with nothing. All it does is confuse you 5 years later to make you wonder if you prayed the right prayer and if you really meant it. Now, if you pray this prayer with all your heart and you'll mean it. No, I'd like to pray it and not mean it. Is that the stupidest thing I ever heard in my life? Well, if you just pray this prayer and mean it, why? Why what? Why mean it? First of all, you can't pray without meaning it, can you? Can you? Thank you, Eric. Not by the definition of prayer, can you? Prayer is the word prosukamai, pro, S-E-U-C-H-O-M-A-I. And it means pros, meaning to motion forward. And this word uke means to will oneself forward or bow down to God. You can't pray to God and not mean it. Now, when somebody says, I remember being willing, well, okay, you were willing. But your willingness came after new birth. And when you're a baby, and somebody says, now, son, you're 3 years old now. Now, you have to accept me as your father. I'm not your father. Oh, Daddy, I want to accept you. Okay, you got to climb this big, tall ladder. And it goes up about 400 feet. And then you got to jump down in my arms. Okay, Daddy. You think a little kid's willing to do that? You bet your life. Little kids are willing to do anything that their daddy says, aren't they? But does climbing the ladder and jumping off into his father's arm make him a son? No. He was already a son when his daddy says, you have to do this. And do you think you can't confuse kids? Yeah. You want to confuse that little boy? Just tell him all next week, how do you know I'm your daddy? I may not be your daddy. Maybe I'm not your daddy. It'll upset him and he'll be crying and weeping all week long. Wondering, oh, God, how can I get, oh, how can I make this my daddy? And you stand over a pulpit and say, how do you know tonight? You might not know. If you don't know, this might be your last opportunity. That's a bunch of hogwash and baloney. I did a tape called Doubting is a Sign of Salvation. Only believers are going to doubt, and all of them do doubt. I ain't going to say no more about that. Now.
Your free will, that prayer, wouldn't that be like an incantation?
I guess it would, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But it all happens. Here's the way it happens. Here's what happens. Let me tell you, and everybody can identify with this. Everybody can identify with this. Here you are, you're riding down the street. You're riding down the street in your car. That's the best I can draw a car, I'm sorry. You're riding down the street in your car, and a radio signal comes in there, and you're riding there, and it hits your radio, and you never heard this truth in your life, and all of a sudden just cuts into your heart. You go, oh, man, oh, God. You didn't try to believe anything. It cuts you to the heart. Has that ever happened to anybody? And you didn't say, I accept Christ as my personal Savior. And you didn't say, let me pray this prayer. You went, oh, God, that's me. Oh, God. What do you think made that happen into your heart? God prepared the ground. He prepared the seed. And he prepared the word from that preacher. And he had you drive along where that signal would hit your heart. But what's so sad is because we've heard all this propaganda just hurting our heart. That nose is too long in that car. What we do, we drive home. We go to our wife. We drive home, go in the house, say, honey, I think I'm having a change of heart. Did you change your heart? When the Bible says that God will give us a heart of flesh, he'll take away our stony heart, did you give yourself a heart transplant? Did you say, here, give me that scalpel, rip, hey, now I'm fixing to do this, I'm going to cut this thing off, I ain't going to have much time, here, give me that quick, so quick. You don't give yourself a heart transplant, do you? God does that, and he gave it to you when the signal came, and you go home, you say, honey, I feel like I'm so different, something's happening to me. You mean you actually did that yourself? No, the word hit your heart. You were elect of God. God cut into your heart. He prepared the ground. He planted the seed. And you say, honey, we've got to go down here. We've got to go down here on this boulevard and this big church down here. And we've got to go down here Sunday morning. And let's park in the parking lot. And I'll go in here. And I've got to walk the aisle and accept Christ. And walk down to that altar. And I've got to pray the sinner's prayer Sunday. No, you don't. The work started right there. He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Believe is the method of salvation. Not sinner's prayer, not accept Christ. Acts 16 chapter, what did Paul say to the Philippian jailer? He didn't say, would you like to go down the Romans road? Would you like to accept Christ? He said, believe. We need to find out what believe means. Belief has to do, believe. Believe equals. How about equals? Believe is the same thing as conforming to the image of Christ. If we conform to the image of Christ, which is predestination, what predestination is about, Romans 8:29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. For whom? Not what he foreknew, the whoms he foreknew. The ones that he prognosco. He knew them. He had a personal relationship with them ahead of time. Ephesians 1 and 4. He hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. 2 Thessalonians 2:13. We are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation. How? Through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. That's the method he's chosen us. It's not just some fatalistic thing. He's chosen us to believe the truth. And he's going to write it in our hearts. And truth, what is truth?
The Holy Spirit.
That's it. And what else is it? It's the Word of God. Thy Word is truth. And truth is something you do, isn't it? John 3:21, he that doeth truth. You have to do truth. He that doeth truth. If you believe truth, you're going to do it. You can't just get saved one night and then live the way you want. He that doeth truth cometh to the light. That's the image of Christ, isn't it? He that doeth truth. Doeth. Truth is doing. He that doeth truth cometh to the light. The light, what is the light? That's the horizo, isn't it? We say horizon. Predestination is the word prohorizo. It means to be forebound inside the light. Means to be forebound inside the truth. Light is something we walk in if we walk in the light. We're going to walk in truth. What I think, if truth is something you do, truth is, what's the word truth? Aletheia. And what's the words it comes from? Lanthano. What does that mean? Lanthano means to lie hid or conceal.
About aletheia.
Huh? Aletheia. Means to lie hid or conceal. And then how do you get truth out of lie hid and conceal?
Putting the alpha privative.
That's the first letter of the Greek alphabet. It's called an alpha privative when it's placed in front of a word. Alpha privative. When it's placed in front of a word as a negative particle, It negates the word and gives an opposite meaning. Placing the alpha in front of lanthano negates the meaning of lanthano. It means not to hide, not to conceal. Placing the alpha privative in front of lanthano translates aletheia. So everything that truth is, when you do the truth, you take the cover off. That's having the Holy Spirit pulling the cover off. Saying, here's a verb, here's a noun, here's the definition. Do you know that you have the truth when you tell people what an alpha privative is correctly? When you define the word truth, that shows that you have the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the truth. So, let me see. We're talking about truth is something you do, you obey. Believe is something. Look here. Conforming to the image of Christ is obedience, isn't it? We're predestined. Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. Prohorizo is the word predestinate. Pre-lighten, pre-bound inside the light. He's pre-bound us inside the light to be conformed to the image of Christ. The word image, E-I-K-O-N, means a likeness or be similar. Predestination is about being like Jesus, and when we start as babies, we don't know how to be. We're just immature children. And if we're going to be like Jesus, that's obedience, isn't it? Didn't Jesus say in John 6:38, I came not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me? Isn't that obedience? Huh? So if we're going to be like Christ, we're going to obey God. Well, is that what belief is? Is it believing obedience? Believe is, what's the word believe?
It's too old.
And what part of speech is that?
Verb.
It's a verb. And what's the noun form of believe?
Pistis.
And what is that word?
Faith.
That's the word faith. That's the noun. Faith and believe are the same word. Now, I heard Fred Price say one night, now, these are two different words. Freddie? You idiot. Go pick up your concordance and get your Greek book out. They're the same word. One's the verb and the other's the noun. But they got a bigger church than we got, so that must make them right, right? Fear not, great, big, huge, worldwide revival. No, fear not, little flock. For it is the Father's heavenly will to give you the kingdom. Few are going to find the narrow gate. Don't you believe all these big worldwide lies. Now, where was I?
Faith is a substance.
So, whatever belief is, faith is, since this is the noun and this is the verb. Well, Romans 10:17. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word is truth, and truth is something you do. The word is something you do. It's something you're obedient to. And people have inevitably said, well, that's works for salvation. No, that's God working in his people to will and to do of his good pleasure. If he don't work in us and cause us to be obedient to him, then we are bastards and no son of his, and he doesn't spank the devil's children.
Isn't that funny? If you're predestined, then you can do anything you want. But if you are obedient to Christ, then that's works.
Yeah. Yeah, they say if you're predestined, you can do anything you want. And we're saying, no, no, we're predestined to conform to be like Christ. And they say, oh, that's works for salvation. Make up your mind.
James 2:17 has the answer to that one.
Yeah.
Even so, faith, if it hath not worked,
works is dead, being alone. Yeah. Faith, if it hath not works. We're not talking about works of self-righteousness, and we're not talking about ritual. Now, faith cometh by hearing. Here is the word akouo, A-K-O-U-O. And believing is, then believing comes by hearing, doesn't it? Believe is by hearing, right? Because believe and faith is the same thing. So when Paul said to the Philippian jailer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, he's saying here, isn't he? Well, the word obey is hoop, A-K-O-U-O. It means to be obedient under, or to hear under. It means to be subordinate to someone, and to hear them, and to hear under them, and be their subordinate. That means we've got a superior, that's Christ. He tells us what to do, or the Father tells us what to do, and we're to be like Christ. Hupakuo is the same basic word as akuo. It's just got hoop meaning under. It means to hear under, or to obey. Well, what's the word obey in the Old Testament? What's the word here in the Old Testament? Shema. Proverbs 20 and 12, the hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord hath made even both of them. So if a man can hear the truth, he will obey the truth. The word hearken, obey, here is all Shema in the Old Testament. So believing is conforming to the image of Christ, isn't it? Predestination is conforming to the image of Christ. Believe is obedience. Conforming to the image of Christ is obedience. So we are predestined to the ones for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to believe. Didn't he? People hate predestination because even the Calvinists don't understand it. The Primitive Baptists don't understand it. Mike was raised in the Primitive Baptist Church. They preach predestination. He said, I never heard conform to his image my entire lifetime, raised in a Primitive Baptist preacher's home. He said, and he never said conformed. He said he never said prohorizo. He never said, well, we know he never said ous, whom. So we're predestined to conform and be like Christ. And what we're doing, we're going through some things about what Jesus was like. I think the best way to find out the likeness of Jesus, which I'm going to go back to this, I'm going to get back to Matthew, the 5th chapter. But when you get into Matthew 5, you get into the first instruction of Jesus in chapter 4. In chapter 4, he's tempted in the wilderness before he goes into his ministry. Chapter 3, he's baptized. Chapter 2, we see him being discovered in the house by the wise men, not in the manger. Then chapter 5, he preaches his Sermon on the Mount, 5, 6, and 7. And this is the greatest sermon in all of history. And he's correcting the Pharisees all through here. So if we're going to be like Jesus, I think probably the best place to start is with his red words, aren't they? Huh? With his red letters. If we're predestined to conform to the likeness of Jesus, now it don't matter whether people believe predestination, it's true. What really bothers me, now you need to learn this. When somebody says they believe in predestination, be sure and tell them to define for you what that means. Because everybody has to believe in predestination. It's in the Bible. But you have to say, what do you believe it means? Some people say, well, I believe God predestined everybody. How can he pre-lighten everybody? Pre-bound inside the light. He didn't pre-bind everybody in the light. He's got vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, Romans 9:22. The Lord has made all things for himself, yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. He did not predestinate everybody. Predestinate is a word that belongs to the believer only because it means to pre-lighten, predetermine for the boundary of the horizon. When you're in the horizon, you can see the light. You're in the light. Men are ordained for hell. They're not predestined for hell. They're ordained for hell. Predestination belongs to the believer only. It means to pre-lighten, predetermine that men will walk in the light. And whether people like it or not, and just because a person is here saying, well, I never heard this before, that don't make it not true. All of the Baptist churches preached this 200 years ago. Where's the Baptist gone? Where have all the Baptists gone? Long time dancing. Is that it? Long time. That's it. They're going dancing. That's it. Now look here. Let me give you. Go to Psalms 110. I just want you to know that I'm not denying that somebody is willing. When your willingness came about, you were already a believer. See, a lot of people trace, look here. Most people, they say, here I am today, I'm saved. Well, first of all, you're not saved today, you're in the process. The word saved is sozo. It means, this is the Greek word, this is the Greek meaning. We can get into all my Greek books. We can take you to Greek professors in seminaries all over the country, and they'll all agree with me, not the preachers. They won't agree with you if you think saved is one night. Saved is, it means to be taken from point A to point B, and to be preserved and protected through the whole deliverance. It's the word sozo. You didn't get saved one night. Now, maybe you remember being willing one night, but look here in verse chapter 110. In verse 2, the Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. Thy people, possessive, he owns them. Jesus came, thou shalt call his name Jesus, Matthew 1:21. He shall save his, possessive pronoun. He owns them. He will save his people from their sin, no one else.
Those are sealed
to his. Yes, they are. The Lord knoweth them that are his. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power and the beauties of holiness from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. And I know what that means, because there was a time every morning I woke up, I reached out and grabbed a telephone and a bunch of contacts to make money. And after God crushed me and beat my brains out, I'd wake up every morning reaching to the phone and say, who can I tell this truth to? From the womb of the morning, when the morning begins to dawn, after God gets through dealing with you, he'll make you willing. But he doesn't. You are not willing, and he doesn't make you willing before he births you. Because when he births you is when you become his son. And then he says, you will be willing, and I'm not denying the willingness of people, but you're only willing when you're a spiritual man and you've been birthed by God. Then you can accept the things of the Spirit of God. Not only will you accept them, he commands you to accept them, but you can't accept anything while you're dead, because God has to do the quickening. Now, look here. We're going to be like Jesus. While we're in this likeness thing, I want us to go back to 1 Peter. 1 Peter. And I'm going to go through some other verses on this. We're talking about how we need to be like Jesus. I brought out these last couple of weeks that we're to forbear one another. And I'm not talking about forbear false teachers. God wants us to call down false teachers. Well, Jesus didn't call them down. Well, you're not reading the same New Testament I'm reading. Because if you read Matthew 23, Jesus stood out in the streets of Jerusalem, pointed to the Pharisees, the Bible-toting preachers, and said, you snakes, generation of vipers, children of hell. Now, call down false teachers. But when someone is a believer, if they're a rebellious believer, call them down and separate from them and don't have anything else to do with them. If they're preachers preaching for money, use cutting rebuke on them. You mean the Bible says that somewhere? Yeah, in Titus, the first chapter. Look here at Titus, first chapter. We'll come back over here to where I'm going in 1 Peter. Go to Titus, the first chapter. Look at verse 10. Well, let's look at 9. Holding fast the faithful word, as he hath been taught, that he may be able to, by sound doctrine, to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Gainsayer means to speak against. Those who are speaking against truth. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped. There are some Jews preaching false doctrine, and they're doing it for money. And they're preachers of the gospel, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not, for money, for filthy lucre's sake. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, the Cretans are always liars. Titus was pastor of the church at Crete, little island out in the Mediterranean. Evil beasts were evil men. The word is therion, T-H-E-R-I-O-N. Slow bellies, the belly was the seat of all sensual desires, they said. The word slow is argos. It means idol. Remember argos? Means unemployed. They were standing around doing nothing. What does employed mean? What's the word for employed? Huh? But what's the Greek word? Huh? Yeah. Love or agape is kind. C-H-R-E-S-T-A-T-O-S. It comes from the word C-H-R-E-I-A. That's the word anoint, and it means employed. When we're employed with a smearing. There's only one baptism. It's a blood baptism, and that's the baptism of truth. When we're employed with truth of the Word of God. When men are slow bellies, they are argos. They're idle, every idle word. In the 12th chapter of Matthew there, 12:36, men are going to give account for every idle word. Slow is the word idle. They're idle bellies. They're sitting around trying to fulfill themselves. This, and he's talking about some preachers. This witness is true. Wherefore, rebuke them sharply. These preachers who are preaching for money use cutting rebuke. Now, that's what we're supposed to do. But when it comes to believers who are struggling with sin, say, I'm having a hard time. Jim, I'm struggling. I don't know how to give up this sin or that sin. I've had people come to me and say, I don't know how to quit smoking, man. I don't know how to do it. I got this problem. A word slips out once in a while because I'm so used to it. Well, kick yourself, and we'll pray for you, and maybe God will help you to learn. I'll tell you what. If you're going to cuss, cuss around me. Okay? I'll fix you. I'll define every one of the words you cuss. I do that. I was up at the gym one day, and one guy said, well, blankety blank, hey, is this word in the Bible to use some dirty word? And I said, yes, it sure is. That's a wonderful word. In fact, Paul said, over in the 3rd chapter of Philippians, he said that he counted all things but dung, but he didn't use the word dung. And I said, that's the word scubalon. He said, I was circumcised the 8th day of Israel. And he said, I was a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a tribe of Benjamin. And he said it was scubalon. And you know what you do to scubalon or dung or the word you used? I said, what you do is they used to put salt on it. And the Bible says we're the salt of the earth. And I was just salting him. And I got through defining the word. And he got cocky and arrogant first. By the time I got through defining it, he was going. I said, if you have any more of those words, bring them to me. I like those. And somebody says, hell, I say, hey, wait a minute. I know that word. Yes, I've got it. Luke, the 16th chapter, the rich man died and in hell he lifted up his eyes. That's where a man goes if he doesn't repent of his sin. That's good. I like that word. See, I define words for people out in public. I don't care what word it is, how bad it is. If you say, don't cuss around me, they're going to cuss, ain't they? If you define their words, say, now come back when you get some more, they're going. And when that guy sees me, he goes, hi, Jim. I say, hi, Eric, how you doing? Not this Eric. I say, how you getting along? I'm doing fine. I don't have any words today. See, if you learn the definitions, define them. And see, all you... That took me into salt, and then I could go into Moreno and go into savor. And See, all you got to do is just get an excuse to preach, and a cuss word is a real good excuse. Just say, wait a minute, come here. I know that word. Come here, man. If they use the F word, I'll say, wait a minute. Pornia. Fornication. Yes, pornia means idolatry. You know where idolatry comes from? It's from Ido, pornia. And it doesn't just mean to look at naked women, pornography. I said pornia is the word, and it means idolatry. And idolatry comes from Ido, lolatria. Ido means to look at, and latria means to serve. It means to serve what you see. And you know what? You know over there in Ecclesiastes 1 and 8, what? I just keep going. So if you'll just send them to me and tell them to cuss around me, I say, that's a good word. I like that. But I'll tell you what, you'll stop them, won't you? It's fun that way. Where was I? He says, rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith. Now, why are they going to be sound in the faith? Because they're believing preachers preaching for money. But you got to use cutting rebuke. Well, I didn't think we were supposed to call down people. Well, what about, look, I don't know if I'm going to get over. Look over here in 1 Timothy. Look at 2 Timothy. Look here at 2 Timothy. Timothy was pastoring the church over here at Ephesus. Hey, if you learn all the words, I'll help you with the words. We'll learn all the cuss words together. Okay? We'll stop them. They don't. He teaches us the cuss words. Hey, if you think that don't stop them, dead. I mean dead. And you get real serious. And that's a really interesting word. That's what I do. That's a really interesting word. Let me do what Paul said. It's really interesting. I'll go over and put my arm around and say, you know, Paul's sitting in there going. Don't let them scare you. Attack them on their own territory. And it does work. Just if they say, some woman said GD one day, I said, well, I knew that God would damn souls, but I didn't know he'd damn that pencil. She said, now don't you start on me. And I looked at her real hard and I said, don't start and I won't start. Turn and walked away. If they say damn, say katakrino. That's a great word. Kato means down and with great intensity. Krino means to judge downward. God means he sends men into condemnation into hell for that. Isn't that a wonderful word? Whew. That's a frightening word to define for somebody. So, you see, all it takes is getting the words down. I did like everybody else when I was 28, 27. Don't cuss around me. And they do. Now I say, cuss around me. Huh? Well, I got one this and tonight. But every word has a biblical equivalent, doesn't it? Every one of them. And where was I going? Oh, I was going to show you. Ephesus. Ephesus is over in the southwest corner of what we call Turkey, Asia Minor. And people say, you shouldn't be calling down preachers. What are you talking about? Did Jesus call down preachers? Stood right in the middle of the streets and said, one of you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, you compass sea and land to make one proselyte, and after he's made, you make him twofold more the child of hell than yourselves. Was that condemning? Called them children of hell. And said, now, you apostles, y'all stay away from them, okay? Yeah. He wasn't screaming at everybody. He was screaming at them. And people say, Jesus never got angry. You mean when he went into the temple, he went, help me turn this table over. they paint these pictures of me, and I'm just a pansy, and it's just too heavy. Kicking through there and screaming at the top of his lungs. Said, you made my father's house a den of thieves. You think he didn't correct some? For some reason, I don't think these guys have ever read the 23rd chapter of Matthew. And you hadn't read the second, you haven't read 2 Timothy, if you think Paul didn't correct people. He said, there are two young preachers preaching down there at Ephesus. Watch out for them. Hymenaeus and Philetus is their words. Verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God. Workman needeth not be ashamed. Rightly dividing means to make a straight cut, means to divide the sentence up into the parts of speech. Tell the truth, pull the cover off. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase into more ungodliness. In verse 17, he tells you what profane and vain babblings are, because there's two young preachers that's involved in vain and profane babblings. And there he says, but they increase to more ungodliness, and their word, the words of men who are preaching profane and vain babblings, and their word will eat like doth a canker. The word is gangrene. I saw gangrene on a TV. A guy got bit by a bear, and it was traveling something like 6 inches an hour. And the word eats like a gangrene, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, two young preachers. Now, Paul said, I'm going to write their names down so everybody can read about them for 2,000 years. People say, not so what's called names? Tell Paul that. Tell Jesus that. Tell Jesus when he stood right in the middle of the streets and said, apostles, listen to me now. Woe unto you! He wasn't nice. People say, Jesus was nice. Not to the Pharisees. He hated those people. Uai. It's the word uai. It's a cry of damnation is what it is. He said, you will be damned, you Pharisees, you snakes. People said, Jesus wasn't mean. They killed him for those words in Matthew 23. He had his last Passover in Matthew 26 just a couple of days later. And the next day after that, he died on the cross. And they did it. They said, let's find a way to kill him for calling us out in public.
Same with Stephen.
Yep, same with Stephen. And their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred. They erred from the truth, saying that the resurrection is past already. All they said was the resurrection. And by the word, that word resurrection, by the way, that word resurrection is A-N-A-S-T-A-S-I-S. Anastasis, it's feminine gender. Jesus wasn't a female. He was saying that the resurrection of the church is, they were saying the resurrection of the church was one time, the night they accepted Christ and got saved. And Paul said, that's a cancer.
He was right.
He was exactly right. He said, that's a canker. When you say the resurrection is past, the word past is genomai. That's a perfect verb. Perfect verb. A perfect verb is a present condition due to a past action. They said the resurrection of the church was one time. Resurrection, anastasis, feminine gender. Anastasis means to come to life after dying. How often does the church die?
Daily.
They take, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. If there's no daily dying and there's no daily resurrection, it's a cancer to say, accept Christ one night and that's it. That's a lie.
Falling away.
It's the falling away, that's right. Now, people say, well, Jim Brown, you sound crazy. Not 200 years ago, I don't. I would have so many friends 200 years ago. Wouldn't it be wonderful to talk to Jonathan Edwards? 400 years ago, I could talk to John Calvin. About 300 years ago, I could talk to John Bunyan. These would be my friends if God let me live to be 200 years old from the 1400s to, from 1500s to the 1700s. Wouldn't that be great? I'd have all kinds of friends. Did Paul call down these young preachers? They said the resurrection was past and they overthrow the faith. What's faith? Obedience? They overthrow the conforming of some. They overthrow what we're predestined to do, conform in obedience to the likeness of Jesus. Now, that's predestination. Two others. Look here. Back to 1 Timothy People say, you shouldn't call people's names. Tell Paul that. Tell Jesus that. Did Paul call Peter's name in Galatians, the second chapter? When Peter dissimulated, he got full of hypocrisy, and he pulled away from some Gentiles he's eating with because he saw James and some Jews coming. He went, I'm not supposed to be eating with the Gentiles. And Paul called him down. He said, Peter, why are you preaching one thing and living another? And he called him down in front of everybody. And he's the Pope without any infallible. Yeah, sure he is. He couldn't even live right here, much less as the daddy of the church, could he? Look here. Paul says to Timothy when he's pastoring at Ephesus, verse 19, chapter 1, 1 Timothy, holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away. They're not holding faith. They're not holding a good conscience. And we got to go back. They're not holding obedience. Which some have put away concerning faith have made shipwreck. You remember the shipwreck, the reefs, the spots on the love feast? One of the words spot is the word spelos. That means a reef in a sea. There's spots in the sea and they're shipwrecking the faith as they come to feast with us, and they're causing some people to quit crucifying. Of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto the Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme and speak against the word of God. These are two believers, because Paul is saying, I'm going to teach them to learn not to blaspheme. Now people say, Jim Brown, you shouldn't call people's names. These are young preachers. Why was Paul calling their names? Look over here in 2 Timothy. Second Timothy, the fourth chapter, is one of the last works that Paul wrote. It's one of the last works that he wrote from a Roman jail in Acts, the 28th chapter. He was ready to have his head cut off, and he, in Alexander, was a believer working in Ephesus, and he worked making shrines to Diana. And he come to church, he came to Timothy's church. And Paul talks about Alexander. Alexander, in the 19th chapter of Acts, sided with all the people of Ephesus against Paul when they drove him into the theatron, into the theater, or to the agon. And they were threatening to kill him because they said he'd come there to destroy their business of making shrines to Diana. And Paul says to Timothy, verse 14, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works, of whom be thou ware. Be aware of Alexander. He's a Christian in your church, and he stood with the enemy to have me killed. You think Paul should write a man's name down for millions of people to read over the centuries? People say, Jim Brown's calling people's names. I don't believe in Kenneth Copeland. I don't believe in Oral Roberts. I don't believe in Billy Graham. I don't believe in Charles Stanley. They preach an easy gospel, no death to self, no daily cross. They preach accept Christ, which is not true. They preach sinner's prayer, which is not true. They preach an easy, slush, mush gospel, no dying, no self, no death to self, no suffering for righteousness' sake. They don't ever say 2 Timothy 3:12, yea, and all that will of God in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And Peter said in the fourth chapter of 1 Peter, he said, we have to enter in if the righteous scarcely be saved, mogus, with great difficulty. Or what Paul said in Acts 14:22, we must through much tribulation enter the kingdom of God. After he was stoned and left for dead outside of Lystra. We don't hear that from the preachers today. And Jesus said in John 16:33, in the world you shall have tribulation. And that we were appointed to that, Paul says in the third chapter of 1 Thessalonians. No man should be moved by these afflictions, knowing that you were appointed thereto. You got an appointment with affliction. Too bad if you don't like it, because if you never enter into it, you don't belong to God. He said, of whom be thou aware? For he hath greatly withstood my words. And my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me, including Alexander. One of your fine young preachers down there, Timothy, he stood with the world concerning their Christmas trees down at the Christmas tree lot. He stood with me against... Diana was just the tree goddess, and that's where it comes from. They wanted to keep selling their Christmas trees. They wanted to keep selling their shrines to Diana. What are you talking about? In Jeremiah 23:1, Jeremiah said, the pastures have scattered the sheep of my flock. Read the 7th chapter of Jeremiah, the 14th chapter of Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter of Ezekiel, the 34th chapter of Ezekiel. In fact, read Jeremiah and Ezekiel. And they'll tell you about who's at fault. It's the pastors, the flock.
Woe to the
pastors that feed themselves. Should not the pastors feed the flock there in the 34th chapter of Ezekiel? He said, I'll require my flock at your hand, and I'll destroy you. I've run out of time, and I hadn't even gotten into being like Jesus tonight.
Same cry of damnation?
Yeah. Whoa. People say Jim Brown shouldn't call preachers names. Well, tell Paul and Jesus that, okay? And they didn't just call their names. They wrote them down in God's holy book so millions of people could read how they did for 2,000 years. How would you like to have your name in there? I'd rather my name be Epaphroditus or Timothy. I have no one like-minded to care for your state like Timothy. Boy, that's what I want said, not, hey, beware of Jim Brown. If the world says beware of Jim Brown, that's okay. I've run out of time and I haven't even got started. I'm going to get back to being conformed like Christ because believing is being conformed to the image of Christ. Predestination's true, no matter whether anybody likes it or not. I'm not here trying to make friends and convince anybody. If you believe, God's written it in your hearts. Let's pray. God, help us in this ministry. You're God, we don't even comprehend. Life gets difficult, it gets sad, I get weary. God, help me. Help us to understand that we have to be conforming to the likeness of Jesus. Whip us and beat us and do whatever you have to do because, Lord, it's our light affliction is but for a moment and it works for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory when you whip us. Whip us how, whatever you need to do to get our attention, make us